Good evening. Welcome to ANU. Welcome to Canberra, if you're not from Canberra. It's my delight to, my name is Kent Anderson. I'm director of the School of Culture, History and Language, and it's my delight to host this evening and welcome our speaker. First though, we meet tonight on the land of the Ngunnawal people, the first Australians, and we acknowledge their elders past and present and respect them and respect their land. Our speaker tonight is, we're delighted to be our fourth Malaysian politician in the last 6 months, and we were just talking about it, and indeed we think we're able to put out so many intelligent audience members and voting members that we should make this a series. But Nurul Izzah Anwar is our speaker this evening, Member of Parliament from Malaysia and Vice President of the PKR, People's Justice Party. She'll be known to everyone in the room as one of the youngest, most energetic, and most driven politicians in the current Parliament of Malaysia, leading the opposition, and of course, she'll be known as the daughter of our speaker in November, Anwar Ibrahim. But she stands on her own and in her own right. And it's because of who she is, not who her parents are, that you're all here this evening, and we're interested to have her thoughts heard in Canberra. They've been listening to her on the other side of the lake, and she needs to make a racing dash to ABC Studios at 9:30. So we're going to have to call it at about 9 o'clock, but I think that gives us more than enough time to meet and get to hear some of the thoughts on current developments in the political situation in Malaysia. With that, let me introduce and turn over to Nurul Izzah. Nurul, welcome.
Thank you, Professor Kent Anderson and the School of Culture, History and Politics to Increase. I just like to say that the title actually is not as the one presented. The title of today's lecture, discussion, whatever you might call it, is The Politics of Hope and Liberation, The Path Towards Democratising Malaysia. Friends, teman-teman seperjuangan, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Salam sejahtera, salam perjuangan, salam reformasi. Firstly, allow me to extend a heartfelt thanks to the kind organisers who have provided me with this valuable opportunity to meet with all of you, Malaysians, friends, supporters and Australians who are sometimes termed the Malaysian watchers. That's a term we use for Australians watching Malaysia. I'm very grateful because I know, again, I'm the fourth installment of Malaysian speakers that have graced all of you, and again, you know, this is a very important opportunity for me. Before giving my talk, I would also like to acknowledge, you know, in this current situation, we are going through an exceptionally turbulent period of natural calamities in such countries as Australia, New Zealand, Japan, and Brazil, and people's uprisings in several Arab nations. I would like to express my condolences and support to all who have died, who have all suffered in these events. Now, ladies and gentlemen, friends, the last time I frequented Australia was prior to the historic events of March 2008, when opposition parties broke the traditional stranglehold of more than two-thirds of seats in Parliament and won power in an unprecedented 5 states. I would like to think that politics would eventually be the vocation of choice for me. However, in all humility, I only have all of you to thank, leading Malaysians, in determining the natural progression into active politics that I took as I stood as a contestant in the last general election. Indeed, the events that stemmed from a rallying call termed reformasi or reform back in September 1998 were breathtaking in its emotional assault, but also more in terms of its long-term impact. On many occasions, I have been represented and, as the daughter of opposition leader Anwar Ibrahim, but I would say more accurately, I am also the daughter or child of reformasi. And in the formative years, you see, following my father's incarceration, I rode on the same path and direction of political parties such as PAS, the Islamic Party of Malaysia, DAP, the Democratic Action Party and eventually Parti Keadilan Nasional at the beginning, Keadilan, and various other non-governmental groups, including the human rights group Suaram, the Islamic Youth Movement, ABIM, Institute Kajian Dasar, and many others. Change is unavoidable, as politics is a dynamic, demanding yet mesmerizing field. I changed that fateful day of my father's sacking in September 1998. This and the events that followed revealed a flagrant misuse of the nation's public and democratic institutions and brought to life, I feel, an innate desire to participate and affect the direction of Malaysia's future. And of course, I was not the only soul anak reformasi. I was with a band of many others who embraced Keadilan as their first political entity. Similarly, I don't know if you know, you've heard the names Nik Nazmi, Nik Ahmad, Sim Tidzin, Chan Ming Kai, Amiruddin Sha'ri, Kesavan, Rafizi Ramli, most of whom are now legislators in their own right, all who embraced reformasi ideals and realised that if we were to remain relevant to the future, we had to work hard to ensure progressive ideals of multiracial politics in practice remain alive and kicking in the Malaysian electoral scene. Above all, we wanted to introduce political reform that would end the misuse of government institutions, introduce real democracy based on the rule of law, and reject the UMNO-dominated government approach of maintaining political power by dividing racial groups against one another. The need for a political contract. I think so much discussion has focused on what exactly we mean when we have, or we say that we have, a social contract. For me, what's important is what your government owes you and what the government's responsibilities are to its citizenry. So this is what's important in having a political contract. In recent months, much effort has gone to debating what, if any, political social contract was entered to when Malaya achieved independence in 1957. So instead of wasting time bickering about this, I prefer to draw attention to the ongoing plans by the ruling National Front, Barisan Nasional, entitled the Government's Transformation Agenda, or their Blue Book. It's really dark blue in colour, so we call it in Malaysia their Buku Biru Tua. And compare this to Pakatan Rakyat's Buku Jingga, because it is orange in colour, which lists our 100-day reform plans, assuming we are given the mandate by the people in the next general elections. Now, in the government's transformation agenda, there are actually four core initiatives outlined, which are the One Malaysia component, the government transformation program in terms of increasing bureaucratic efficiency, economic transformation programs, including nuclear energy component as one of the ETPs, and the 10th and 11th Malaysia plans as the implementing tools. Our central point is, versus their plans, is that Malaysia must implement political reform, since we can no longer afford the collusion of different organs in our democracy, which greatly infringes upon the rights of the people, the rakyat of Malaysia. To advance the cause of the Buku Jingga, the Orange Book, Pakatan Rakyat legislators, since August of last year, had written several letters to my Prime Minister and made other efforts for constructive engagement with stakeholders from all sides of the political divide. These include a series of articles with the aim to advocate for a bipartisan Democracy Rehabilitation Act to be jointly tabled, debated and passed in Parliament. Now the Act, ladies and gentlemen, friends, consists of six items, which are: first, to revoke all emergency declarations. We have emergency declarations that are in effect for the past 47 years. Egypt had 30 and now revoked. Number two, to repeal all emergency ordinances. Number three, to uphold the 20-point Sabah and 18-point Sarawak agreements as promised prior to the formation of Malaysia in September 1963, to ensure free and fair elections, and to establish local government elections as they were suspended in 1964 through the emergency ordinance, and finally to guarantee the rights of a free media. Now to date, the efforts to reach out has been largely ignored. But in the current parliamentary sitting, my Pakatan Rakyat friends and I have submitted an application for a private member's bill. Usually the minister's bill will be the order of the day. But it's okay, we are still prepared with a proper bill as a democracy test case called the Emergency Revocation Act. Malaysia, as I mentioned, has been under emergency rule whereby any decrees issued are not subject to judicial review since the 1960s. A constitutional amendment in 1960 provided that an emergency remains in place until revoked in Parliament. Emergency rule has been invoked on four occasions. In 1964, because of confrontation with Indonesia, which has long ended. 1966 and 1977, to address state political problems in Sarawak and Kelantan. In 1969, following the deadly racial riots in Kuala Lumpur. We have called for this emergency declaration to be revoked, and there because there are 82 related ordinances and laws that stem from the emergency laws that in their totality and intent was meant for a different time and serves a different purpose. Whether this bill sees the light of day is subject to a very constrained parliamentary procedural framework created by the second Prime Minister, Tun Abdul Razak, that limits the efficacy of the opposition to perform their legitimate duties as elected representatives in Parliament. This is again seen as an anti-democratic element that characterises the nature of how government sits in the day. Now, in addition, ladies and gentlemen, Dato' Ambika Srinivasan, who was formerly the President of the Bar Council of Malaysia and now is the Chairperson for the Coalition for Free and Fair Elections, Bersih 2.0, have agreed and we have submitted with me an application to obtain a publishing permit for another bipartisan initiative, a weekly newspaper called Utusan Rakyat, People's Message, which is still pending. My involvement, together with Dato' Ambika, merely as members of the advisory board of the paper, and we are still waiting for the Barisan Nasional Member of Parliament, YB Yang Mulia Tengku Razali, MP for Gua Musang, waiting for his agreement to join us in this initiative. You see, you must always have room for bipartisan arrangements. And the process usually takes at least 2 months, and after that, I will mount statements to attack them, but until then, we just give them time. Again, this is another example of the political environment that the opposition and the people have to work with, where democratic space is controlled with no free press, like what some other nations enjoy. Lack of information, no transparency, lack of accountability, and lack of democracy. Now, I am proposing sort of a new, how shall we call it? It's termed a new universal doctrine for democracy, a term used for political contract. We can change the name later on. But I believe it's important to mention here tonight because it's a testament of what is needed to bring Malaysia forward. And it has been sort of moved by a lot of opposition members of parliament, especially from the Pakatan Rakyat Coalition. Now, we have embarked on another initiative of the same cause, which is to advocate for political reform and rehabilitation of democracy of Malaysia. And I think the younger generation has an opportunity here to embrace what we call a new universal doctrine for democracy, a reflection of new kinds of politics based on hope, liberation, much inspired by what happened in Egypt. I'm totally aware that many similar attempts have been made by others, where we felt compelled to reframe it from the perspective of members of the younger generation, unburdened by the baggage of history, but instead inspired by the aspiration to remake or build a free, democratic world for everyone. The youth live by ideals and the hope for a better future. The central component of the doctrine is free and fair elections. Sovereignty lies with a legitimately elected government, chosen in free and fair elections. Therefore, sovereignty is not based on geographical borders or with the instruments of power, but rather on democratic rights of the people. For example, in Libya, the world community, or specifically the Arab League, has recognized the legitimacy of the opposition and not Gaddafi. In such an extreme case, we see most of the world beginning to recognize the legitimacy of the people's uprising in the streets rather than sitting government, as it is recognized as the popular expression of the will of the masses. Hence, in essence, recognizing the legitimacy of an entity centers around one common variable, which is the expression of the people's will. But if this expression of the people's will is denied or manipulated at the ballot box, then this action is tantamount of denying and robbing the democratic rights of the people. The world should not recognize this or any erroneously elected government as being legitimate, and hence is not under the sovereignty rights of a state. The act to deny or manipulate a free and fair election is an act of political piracy. This is even worse than the conventional piracy on the high seas at the Gulf of Aden against Somali pirates that witnessed a coordinated and concerted international response with the justification that a ship registered and carrying the flag of another nation is under the sovereignty of a state when international waters justifies an international response. But apart from international law, the main reason for such a swift international response is that the Somali pirates are a threat to world trade. Then political piracy of denying the people the democratic right of a free and fair election is also a threat to international peace and democracy and warrants a similar international attention and response. In the case of sovereignty and international jurisdiction on the high seas, a vessel registered and flying the flag of a nation it's registered in is considered the sovereign property of the state nation. The ship or vessel is the sovereign artifact. Now, if you were to extend the same argument that the ballot box is like the vessel, it's a sovereign property of the people and not the government of the state, as the ballot box is the instrument that defines and confers legitimacy and sovereignty to the elected representatives, then the international community has the legal, ethical and moral right to respond to any government that denies and manipulates the election process. Therefore, the ballot box and election process, which is the universal democratic right of a people, would be under international jurisdiction for verification and certification by an international election framework, a commission, preferably within the United Nations framework. In the event that the election were determined to be rigged and the process unfair, then the international community must demand a new supervised election barring, which, if it is rejected, calls for immediate international response that could begin with a travel ban, asset freeze, ICJ, International Commission of Jurists, indictment and sanctions against the government leaders, their families and proxies who are deemed political pirates. The best example for this is the international response and outcry against Syed Mahmud, who's now the Chief Minister of Sarawak. And of course, we're seeing upcoming state elections in the next couple of weeks. The legality and more importantly, the morality of such international response is a just cause. If governments welcome international response to assist materially and militarily in times of natural disasters or in defence of her borders, then the international community has a moral imperative and just cause to defend the sovereignty of the people's ballot box, which determines the legitimacy of the elected government to represent them. We have brought forth among the efforts, these are our demands to the Election Commission of Malaysia to ensure free and fair elections, including the use of indelible ink, as is done and was done in Indonesia and India to prevent multiple voting, the abolition of postal votes because these are not subject to the usual public scrutiny and have always overwhelmingly favoured the government, except for diplomats and overseas voters. And of course, in the latest announcement by the Election Commission, we have an additional 80,000 postal votes because wives of army personnel are included in the next elections. A complete revision of the electoral roll to ensure that the existing irregularities are removed and a roll with full integrity is in place. And all contesting parties to enjoy fair access to state-owned media, especially television and radio. They'll be very useful rather than having to go to very far-flung out public rallies and not being able to reach out to all your voters. Effective governance and public transparency of campaign finance to eliminate corrupt practices, which include state finance to parties for compulsory capacity building for women candidates and marginal groups and gender sensitivity training. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we are still hopeful that the path forward for Malaysia can be fruitful, can be of a positive outcome. I feel that despite the challenges, tribulations that we face, post-2008, we're actually seeing the possibility of a two-party system coming to be realised in a Malaysian scene. And I feel personally, because whatever I'm saying here tonight to all of you is exactly the same things I mentioned in my own home country. And when you term, or when you look at the term of being an opposition legislator, you are the loyal opposition. In the first parliamentary sitting in Malaysia, they term the loyal opposition, loyal to the king, loyal to the nation. It does not mean that we're not given the right to constructively criticise the government of the day. It does not erode our patriotism one bit. Of course, when you talk about universal doctrine for democracy, we will face many, many challenges. But I'd just like to end, before we break for Q&A, with a compelling reminder that all democratic governments in the world, including Malaysia, including Australia, owe it to the people, especially the young generation, that will inherit the burden and pay the price of a failed, illegitimate, anti-democratic government. So at the end of the day, we must come together and we must work together in the effort of further increasing the democratic space for the benefit of everyone. Thank you very much.
I'm going to be air traffic controller and why don't you stay here and I'll just move.
Okay.
Yes, please.
For an outsider of Malaysian politics, could you explain what's the current political situation in contrast to what you've said about democracy that your party is proposing?
The current political situation? You mean the challenges we face, or?
Yeah, I mean, what's the status quo now, and how hard is it to implement democracy, or what are the challenges you face implementing this program you are?
Academicians usually term Malaysia as a semi-democratic state. Right now, well, in the last general elections, it was the first time that the opposition managed to deny the two-thirds control of the government in the parliament. So meaning out of 222 seats, we garnered about 81 seats. And we won 5 states initially, but there was a constitutional crisis and power grab, so we lost one. And now we are governing 4 states, which have been successful in receiving a 4-star rating from the Auditor General's Office, Malaysian government agency. We're doing better than any of the federal government ruled states. You ask me about the challenges facing Malaysia. Various institutions of government, for example, the Election Commission, is theoretically independent, but what happened in the last general election was just a couple of days before election was supposed to take place, the government had procured 2.4 million ringgit worth of indelible ink to be used on voters who have voted. And the Election Commission was going to proceed with that move to introduce indelible ink in the elections, but then the ministers in cabinet met and ordered the Election Commission to cancel its use, citing security issues. The Attorney General also issued a letter, including the police chief at the time. So in my dialogue with the Election Commission Deputy Chairman, I asked him, if you were really independent, why do you have to be subservient to the orders of the cabinet minister? You should have decided on your own accord. His reply was, yeah, in theory we are independent, but we are answerable to the Attorney General's chambers, we are answerable to the government, and we have to follow orders. So there's a close relationship between the Election Commission with the government of the day, which really presents a lot of difficulties for the opposition, because a lot of the laws during election are skewed in favour of the incumbent. That's one. For the media, I mentioned that we don't have access, the opposition doesn't have access, because we have in place the Printing Presses and Publications Act, which requires you to have to renew your permits annually for a particular paper. And almost all mainstream media in Malaysia, more than 95%, are either directly owned directly by the ruling party or indirectly owned by the ruling party. So in the case of the opposition leader or any legislators, it's very difficult for us to get coverage or present, for example, what are our plans to govern Malaysia, what are our policy alternatives, and we have to do so through public rallies. Public rallies are rarely granted permits by the police. So, I mean, The democratic space is certainly not as optimum as we would like. Having said that, we are working within the confines and we are doing our best to ensure change take place via the ballot box. So all the political parties in the opposition coalition is committed and respects the election process as a way forward for us. Yes.
Two-part question. Could you comment about racial politics in Malaysia? And the second one is, which you think is more the pressing concern in Malaysia, racial politics or corruption in government?
It's a very interesting question. I think when you talk about racial politics, well, it has been in existence in Malaysia. The three main component parties of the Barisan Nasional are racially based. The UMNO, Malays, the MCA, Chinese, and MIC, Indians. From the perspective of my party, in the past, even though there have been efforts to cultivate or create a multiracial party, in terms of traction on the ground, it has been somewhat dismal. However, I think right now, Keadilan has managed to gather a congregation of different races in the party, and we are actually practicing, for example, in my constituency, every single day, it's a mixture of Malays, Indians and Chinese at the division level. And it takes hard work. You know, you have to cultivate a new culture. But for me, coming back to what Tariq Ramadan says in his book, What I Believe, multiracialism is a fact. That's a fact for Malaysia. You compare to other nations, many, many other races involved. I mean, for me, once we start based on that premise, that it is a fact of life in Malaysia, it's what really enriches our culture, enriches us as a nation, then you can move on forward. I mentioned a few names of young personalities who joined the party. We do believe that multiracialism is the way to go forward. And I think if more younger people who really do not have this racial baggage speak out in favor and in support of multiracial politics, then we'll be focused more on issues rather than race. After more than 30 years of the implementation of the new economic policy, 80% of the rural poor are still represented by Malays. It's not working. So what we are advocating is, looking at it rationally, objectively, we want to help the majority of the Malays and Bumi Putras of Sabah and Sarawak who are still dirt poor by implementing a discriminative policy based on needs. So I feel we have to take away the subject of discussion away from racial politics. That shouldn't be the main focus anymore. I would say things are worsened with the existence of groups like Perkasa, which has been sponsored openly by UMNO leaders, including the former Prime Minister, because it doesn't help anyone. I think it just propagates hate and a lot of bitterness, and I don't feel comfortable with that. That's why when I asked Perkasa, let's join in a debate, we discuss what are the problems facing the Malays. Is their economic condition that gives them a sense of being sieged, being victimized? But they respond by lodging police reports, you know, asking that the government use the Internet Security Act to arrest leaders who dare question Malay rights. So I think right now it is very unhealthy to go on that line. You know, we have to bring back the discourse rationally as possible. Now, you also mentioned the fact that what's more important, racial issues or corruption? I mean, and nothing should be about race. You have corrupt Malay leaders, you have corrupt Chinese leaders, you have corrupt Sarawakian leaders. If you're corrupt, you're corrupt. I mean, it should be based on that. You know, why? I don't think, you know, once you start thinking that if you're corrupt, I don't care what colour is your skin, but you're not a good leader, you're not a fit leader. And that's why right now, I try very hard. For example, when Tony Pua was attacked, he brought up the issue of the 6 billion ringgit given to build offshore petrol vessels, direct tender through a selected company. So he said that, why are we making such a huge purchase? Why do we have to build it in the first place when we haven't done a great job with Proton? At the time, this is a fact. I think it's important to be rational about it. Now, at a time where subsidies are being cut, it doesn't really make any economic sense. Now, he was attacked by the defense minister as well as the chief admiral of the Navy. Now, I go back to history. In 1997, OPVs, offshore petrol vessels, were also built. Not on time, and incurred us almost 1 billion ringgit in debt. And the Royal Malaysian Navy criticised and were very angry because they were not happy and satisfied with the specifications. So, again, when we talk about corruption, I think it's costing the country billions of ringgit. And we can very ill afford it. The latest, of course, estimate is about 28 billion ringgit per year, conservative estimate, announced and admitted by the Deputy Finance Minister himself. And we mentioned that we have to really strengthen our resolve and moves to curb corruption and leakages. For the 2010 budget, operational expenses, we spend about 18.4 billion ringgit every year just for government debt services alone. Meaning just to pay our debt every year, 18.4 billion ringgit. So it brings to mind how we're going to finance this new project called the Mass Railway Transit, which is going to cost us 70 billion ringgit. So, I mean, corruption, leakages, these are important issues that we should be talked upon, or they should be discussed by everyone. And I think they're more important than issues of race, because race, really, if you look at ordinary Malaysians, day-to-day basis, it does not matter. It's more the politics of hyping race. And using race to win over support during elections that is harming the relationship among Malaysians. Thanks. Mr. Traffic Controller?
I'm just going to let you do it.
Really? I see a girl with a yellow t-shirt there.
What does Pakatan Rakyat plan to do about ISA and racial discrimination?
Do you want me to collect the questions and then maybe the second one? I collect three questions. So can I just, the guy just now who raised your hand? Oh. Black t-shirt, yes.
Okay, thank you.
And then the guy with the checkered shirt, MCKK boy.
Thank you very much for your speech. I want to ask, you mentioned about the legitimacy of civil rights and democracy, but how do you, or you should define or judge it? Because I think it is a really difficult task with, you know, diversity of like religions and ethnic groups like the country in Malaysia.
How are we going to do it? Okay, thank you. The last one, MCK boy, yes?
Yes, thank you. You did mention in this book when you were interviewed for diplomacy changes everything, and in light of Sarawak state election, what is Pakatan Rakyat's hope for this election, and what is your hope for this state election?
Thank you. You asked about our promises regarding the International Security Act. I will really invite you to frequent our the Buku Jingga or Orange Book promises made by Pakatan Rakyat, which is exactly sort of our promise, our common policy platform, as well as promise on a slew of reforms that will take place first 100 days if we were given a mandate. You can look for it on the internet. One of the promises is to ensure that we abolish the Internal Security Act, including bring the Petronas, the petroleum national company, including the Malaysian Anti-Corruption Commission, the Election Commission, under the purview of the Parliament, not influenced by the executive or the Prime Minister's department. So these are our promises, because I think what is lacking in any government agenda right now is the will and readiness to implement political reforms to in line with the spirit enshrined in our federal constitution. So please take a look at those. Now, as far as for civil rights, and we have diversity of religions in Malaysia, I think maybe if I understood your question correctly, you're bringing up the issue or concern of security in such a multiracial context in Malaysia. You know, that's what is important when we talk about democratizing the space for Malaysia, even to the point of revoked, sort of abolishing ISA, we must understand there are other sufficient safeguards for security. We have a very powerful police act in Malaysia, you know, but to allow people to be detained without trial under repressive law, which was created by the British, without bringing them to court for seven, I have known one family. He's been arrested for 7 years, being called a terrorist. And in the end, they released him just about last year, without even charging him in court, no charges whatsoever. And I think this is a commitment we have when we say we're against Guantanamo Bay and everything else. You know, there are other sufficient safeguards in the country. And I think if you're consistent, right now what the people want is consistency. I bring the issue of the Malay Bible texts, which are now being held at the Port Klang station by the authorities, about 5,000 left over. You know, when there's no inconsistency, when certain states you can use Allah, Christians can use Allah, and certain states you can't, it does create a lot of confusion in a multiracial setting. I think at the end of the day, you want a consistent, clear policy that applies to everyone, and the sense that any Malaysian feels that they are treated fairly, and that will be the basis to where you cultivate harmony between or among the various races. In fact, I was quite proud of the Islamic Party, because in this regard they have been very committed and consistent with their position that Christians be allowed to use Allah, similar to a lot of the Abrahamic faiths throughout history. So this is an important issue, because if you use this as a polemic to drive a wedge among Malaysians, it's a very dangerous weapon. So transparency and being consistent on all issues related to either different faiths, religion, races is the best way to go forward. And never underestimate the wisdom, maturity of the Malaysian people. And I think at the end of the day, they will appreciate a political contract that ensures the government to be more accountable and responsible to the people. There are last questions on reformasi in terms of what we hope for elections in Sarawak. One of the wonderful things I noted post the 2008 general elections is the fact that Sabah and Sarawak has been more of a focal point, being raised in Parliament as an issue compared to previous times, not only by us, but also by Barisan Nasional, Federal Government Members of Parliament. Everyone's racing to say, you know, how about Sabah and Sarawak, how about their rights, I know they're impoverished. And I think this is a healthy development for the two states that have been mired in poverty for so long. As far as our campaign goes, we are following the instruction of the head of Sarawak, Keadilan, which is Mr. Barubian, a very active advocate of native customary rights. He's been appearing in cases time after time, because this is this sensitivity, this peninsular Malaysians, how dare they come to Sabah and Sarawak, you know, instructing this and that. So all political leaders, myself not excluded, you know, we have to follow strict instructions. Where do we go, what do we say, and make sure that we respect the demands must be made by the Sarawakians themselves. And I think once we get that cleared up, we can perhaps, our target is definitely more than 30 seats in the next state elections. It's not going to be easy, because you're racing against time. At most, probably we get 1.5 weeks to campaign. And how do you then navigate your way to the long houses in the interiors and meet as many as people as possible. And then, of course, there's a question, can you even understand their language? Can you even speak their language if you're not with a native? But we'll do our best. There were some offers to sponsor helicopters for the opposition last elections. Unfortunately, we did not have landing permits. So it would be like having a helicopter and then, oh, I'm sorry, you can't land here. Great. So it's going to be the long way. It's going to be taking a boat and really taking 7 hours to get to one place and meet 40 voters. But I have faith. You know, we have a lot of local leaders who have been working very hard in the area. Barubian is orang ulu. And I think it really gives us perspective of the challenges that they face and the commitment to be with us in Peninsular Malaysia to advance their cause. I remember I was in Cebu during the by-election, and it was funny because the first question they asked me, anak Anwar. And then I said, yeah, saya datang daripada Parti Keadilan Rakyat, I'm from the People's Justice Party. Oh, Parti Anwar. But no, but you know, it took us 3 election cycles to get to this stage, trust me. When I first went, you know, like, okay, this is our new political party. It was such a struggle to introduce a new brand, as you call it, to the voters. No, I only know BN. I only know, you know, UMNO, MCA, MIC, and of course SNAP in Sarawak. So it's really sort of a progression for me, and quite exciting times. And what saddens me, of course, is when you go to Cebu and you see the natives there waiting beside the drain to go home, you know, completely stuck in poverty, and it just brings to mind like how can you let this continue? They are orang Dayaks, and it's just very sad for me. I mean, coming from Peninsula, I can go back to my home, yeah, but it's just that it really drives us to sort of see a change of regime and do something meaningful, especially with regards to the 18 and 20 point agreements for Sabah and Sarawak. Okay, any other questions? No? Yes?
If I'm not mistaken, in the 2008 general election manifesto, you mentioned there would be local council elections. But in Selangor, I think 3 years has gone by, you've appointed special councillors for this local council elections, and nothing has gone on. So, there's no
offence meant. No, please, feel free to ask.
The promise of the LTE reflection of what we expect if PKR does get into future Jaya, will PKR walk the talk and deliver manifesto promises?
Thank you. Now, for Selangor and Penang, yes, we did promise local government elections in the last general elections. And the problem with local government elections is the best way to move on that motion is to ensure that it's managed by the Election Commission. The cost is very, very expensive. And right now, let me just give you a take. For example, Selangor gives amounts in terms of gratuity to the federal government to the tune of 1.5 billion ringgit in one particular year. But we get back from the federal government about 500 million. So a lot of the government state resources are spent, given back through via gratuity grants. That's one. So one move we had done is to ensure 1/3 of the local councils are given to non-governmental NGOs. And we had asked the Election Commission to actually help us in conducting local government elections for Selangor. Similarly, Penang also moved that motion because they have the state apparatus. It'll be so much cheaper and so much, it makes more sense for them to organise local government elections in both Pulau Pinang as well as Selangor. So it's not exactly not fulfilling the promise. It's not perfect, but I believe under the constraints, when we explain to the electorates, especially people of Selangor, including the groups that are advocating local government elections in Power, in Penang, the representative for the chief minister have met and had so many sessions with the various NGOs to ensure eventually we can conduct local government elections. Those have somewhat fulfilled their expectations for now. But still, in the context of Kuala Lumpur also, I mean, I feel that we must move in the next elections. We have to find a way to ensure the Election Commission implements local government elections in all the states. It is really doable by them. Thank you. Any other questions? Yes.
I wanted to ask about the NGO movement. I think your father was very active with the Societies Act many years ago. To some extent, I think the NGOs in Malaysia, particularly the advocacy ones, are quite constrained. Would your party be in favor of, reducing some of the constraints on these NGOs and giving them more scope for effective action, such as we see in other countries, including Indonesia, etc.?
Well, I think there's a huge problem when regards to how the Societies Act is managed and is used. And we do want to see a more vibrant civil society movement in Malaysia. For now, the one that has been outlined in the promise, and I don't want to add on, you know, for now is the ISA and, of course, the PPPA, Printing Presses Publications Act, including the Police Act, and the University Colleges Act that bar students from actually participating in political life. But we are in close communication with many NGOs, and I feel that it would be a good move to actually enlarge their scope so that they can be more active without much focus or much observation by the security apparatus. Yeah, that is something that we are looking into, although it's not stated explicitly in the Orange Book promise. Thank you. Yes?
I have a quick technical question. Is there a discrimination in terms of the way the federal government treats the PN-controlled states and the non-controlled states, especially in terms of state funding? And if so, how do you...
You know, this whole issue after the opposition controlled most of the states have brought to mind how important is the concept of federalism being practiced. And, you know, there are instances where the federal government will try to reduce assistance, or maybe in some cases they do give assistance to showcase or to try to win over a particular state. But at the end of the day, I think we have to restructure the way gratuity grants are being exercised, because it's so focused in terms of the state giving so much back to the federal government and getting back so little. That's why the promise of 20% royalty payments for states that actually produce petroleum and gas is something worth considering. So there is a balance between what is naturally within the state's purview versus what is controlled by the federal government. I understand the need to have a strong executive, but I think in Malaysia it's a little bit, it's more harmful rather than assisting the growth of certain states. And of course, having said that, most of the economic plundering in Sabah and Sarawak takes place by the local leaders. So you can't exactly blame everything on the federal government. So we are looking into several restructuring mechanisms to improve how federalism is being practiced in Malaysia. And I feel that the most important, like I mentioned, the gratuity grants payment, but second also the powers that state has. Right now it's, you know, land, religion, little else, you know, and the federal government controls in terms of education, even the police force. They should be moved to decentralize and spread that power arrangement. That would be the best way forward. So at least any issues of too much or too little projects being given can be addressed in a more transparent and accountable manner. Anyone else? Okay, just after you, then him.
In regard to fairness, what's your opinion on Malaysia's judiciary independence? Do you think they are legally independent, or are they affected by any political way?
Thank you. The other one?
I'm also an outsider of the Malaysian politics. You defeated in the last election quite strong and important incumbent.
was it surprising at all to you, or what was really appealing to the people that made you, very attractive?
Thank you. Now, the issue of fairness. You sure you want to ask me? Okay, I'll refer to the facts and figures. There is a report by the International Commission of Jurists as well as the International Bar Association which states that the Anwar Ibrahim and Lim Guan Eng trials were deeply affected by or influenced by the executive in terms of its outcome. That was entitled Malaysia Justice in Jeopardy, Justice in Jeopardy Malaysia 2000. So that report effectively documents what are the basic flaws in the cases. We also have the V.K. Lingam expose, which the Royal Commission of Inquiry on the V.K. Lingam expose had unearthed, meaning a key lawyer who basically was found to have this conversation with the future Chief Justice discussing possible appointments and elevation of various judges. So this is well documented. And the problem is, then the Attorney General says they have not done anything wrong in law. So you can actually influence the appointment of several key judges and be the Prime Minister, but that's fine under Malaysian law. And thirdly, the fact that the Chief Justice of Malaysia was formerly the legal advisor for UMNO, I forget the years, but from, yeah, here it is. The current Chief Justice, Tun Zaki bin Tun Azmi, was the former ruling party UMNO's legal advisor and member of UMNO's disciplinary board appeal panel from 1984 to 2007. And in early 2008, he was appointed president of the Court of Appeal. And a year later, he became the Chief Justice. And he was challenged in court by lawyer and also member of parliament, Karpal Singh, regarding an audio recording of him saying, and today he has not denied, "It took me 6 months to be nice, to bribe each and every individual to get back into their good books before our files were being attended to." So that's what you have. I will not add on more of Anwar Ibrahim sodomy trials. I think that would be going too far. But suffice to say, clearly we have an issue with the non-independence of Malaysia's judiciary. Now, regarding the question of the 2008 win, I think for me and many, many other legislators, it was a huge surprise. Dato' Sri Shahrizad, of course, is a very, very famous, if not the most famous, candidate for Barisan Nasional. That's my view. And I believe that it was more of the partly protest votes by the voters, partly also the fact that people found out about the V.K. Lingam expose at the time. There was a Hindraf rally, as well as Bersih rally for free and fair elections. All these things culminated into a deep sense that Malaysians wanted change, and she was no exception. So I believe that I'm thankful and grateful for the opportunity, but I think it's also crucial not to implement half-baked reforms. That's why right now, I made sure when you mentioned the question of readiness of the opposition, we must prepare these bills and we must make sure the public has access to them in terms of, okay, we want to revoke the ISA, what do you want to replace it with? So I'm working with Lawyer Buruk, a group under the Bar Council. I know it's a terrible name, but they're real lawyers. I checked their CVs and they, you know, Edmund Bond, etc. But we're working on clear bills, you know, once you want to abolish Printing Presses and Publications Act, replace it with Media Council, but we must have real bills to showcase that these are indeed our commitment to political reform, and we're going to do this, and we're not going to be thinking two ways about it. Any other questions? Yes, Professor Kent.
One of the nice things about not being air traffic controllers, I can ask a question.
Okay.
But it will be a little bit different than the others. As you can see tonight, there are many Malaysians studying in Australia, many Malaysians studying about Australia. Comparatively, there's very, very few Australians studying about Malaysia.
You have to. It's a very important country.
So my first question is, does that matter? And if it does matter, what might Malaysia do in exercising some soft power to promote Malaysian studies in Australia?
I shall bring your suggestion to the Minister of Education in Malaysia, as well as the Minister of Foreign Affairs, whom I just met. I just met the American ambassador, the Malaysian ambassador to America, sorry, Dr. Jamal Dinjar, just last week. Yeah, I don't think there's a problem. We do have meetings with various government representatives, and it is a good idea. And I believe for Australia's perspective, you know, Malaysia is such a crucial country with regards to, you know, it's a moderate Muslim nation, and we have so much potential. And I feel that while focus has been largely on Indonesia and East Timor, specifically Indonesia's reforms, Indonesia's reformasi movement, a similar focus should be given to Malaysia, because our trajectory and our history has been somewhat different, but could be well appreciated by everyone, including Australians. And I think one good thing about the current Prime Minister, he's been more friendly to Australia compared to his two predecessors, which is, I think you know about him, Barry Wynne wrote a book about him, but this is a great opportunity actually, and I think that even the Prime Minister's visit here was well received, and it could be very well a good start where Australians should and would start studying about Malaysia. No excuses. So I hope, Professor Kent, you owe up to your suggestion. I expect you to reply my emails on this matter. Thank you. Yes, first the person at the back and then the blue shirt, third guy. Yes.
You seem to be very discontent with the entrenched problem of corruption in Malaysia, or issues arising from corruption such as arbitrary abuse of power by the government. The major reform suggestions in your video seems to rely a lot on development of democracy to safeguard people's interests from corruption. Don't you think that it might be too late to wait for democracy to be mature and bear its fruit? Why isn't PKR trying to tackle the problem of corruption directly? Thank you.
The last one with the guy in the blue shirt, yes.
Yeah, I have two questions. The last election, we saw a lot of political jump things, right?
Defections.
What's in place to prevent this from happening? Because it really, a lot of voters were dissatisfied. You know, we voted for the opposition. Next thing you know, they would be in. What is in place to prevent that? And number two, what if, just say you, the opposition will get a mandate, what steps are there in place to improve the current education system of Malaysia?
That's two questions.
Yeah.
Right. Now, you know, you mentioned the history of corruption. They mentioned the history of corruption. I think that the fact that we were trying to implement political reform within 100 days upon assuming power is a crucial point. You must look at the deep relationship between business interests as well as political parties in Malaysia to understand that without political reform, you cannot achieve much. I go back just on the example of the project Leburaya Utara Selatan, the PLUS Highway, which was introduced in 86. That was the first highway project in Malaysia, well documented in Barry Wynne's book. And the Malaysian government decided to give a 30-year concession to this company called UEM, Sdn. Bhd. And at the time, it was given with sort of risks borne by the federal government that if they did not reach their expected profits, the government will bear all remaining risks. And through various research conducted, it was found that the majority shareholder of UEM was Hatibudi Sdn. Bhd. After much pressure brought upon by the lawsuits by YB Kitsiang, he actually sued the government because he said that you cannot give direct tender, award direct tender, and lose out the public interest. But he lost the case and was sent to under ISA. And in Parliament, when Karpal Singh pressured the then Minister of Transportation, Sami Velu replied that Hatibudi is an UMNO company. So if you have such a sheer, unheard of relationship collusion when privatization, a highway contract is awarded to by the political party in power to its own political party, then you can imagine what is needed to be done can only be done if there's political reform. Why would UMNO, in this case, an interested party, divest its interests, divest its shares when it's making so much from this initiative? Similarly, talking about the independent power producers, we are told by the Malaysian government that the 19 billion subsidies per year for independent public power producers is justified because we get lower gas prices for the ordinary consumer. When we did a study on this, comparing to Thailand, Thailand's subsidy, so Thailand's gas are pegged to the market rate, we are actually paying average consumer 22% higher for electricity tariffs compared to people in Thailand. So again, I say, without transparency, without really accountability, it's very difficult to expect any changes will take place. And again, independent power producers, you know, it's talking about 19 billion ringgit per year that we have to bear. So I don't see how we're going to reform economically. You look at even the fact that National Economic Advisory Council came up with a very good new economic model, which was supported by the opposition lawmakers. Unfortunately, because Perkasa gave such a strong resistance and protest, the Prime Minister backtracked in some of the pronouncements. And we have lost so much time, in fact, more than 1 year, before certain key initiatives are supposed to be implemented. So again, you know, political reform is the main ingredient here. You cannot focus on other things. And we've raised these issues. In fact, if you look at the strategic director of Keadilan, he's been releasing issues of economic efficiency. We have papers and speeches to this effect. Please, I welcome you to frequent the party's website, including articles in The Edge, which do get covered, but The Edge Malaysia, you know, has such small readership that it's almost inconsequential, except for Angelina and me. Okay, now, the other questions you asked about defections. Yes, I'm always reminded by what happened to PAS, the Islamic Party, when their president left the party in the late 70s. I mean, and we are learning from the fact that following the takeover by Tun Guru Nur Aziz, he introduced a slew of local and internal reform initiatives to ensure and cultivate loyalty towards the party at the time. And I think for Keadilan, you know, it is important for us to understand, unfortunately, we don't have much time to learn. We only came to being in 1999, but like it or not, we're now one of the biggest opposition parties and we have to get our act together. And one of the most important developments, which I note, is the fact that all young Keadilan leaders, who basically are first-time members of the party, we never joined UMNO, we never joined PMCA, we never joined MIC, have all stayed true. Have all stayed very committed to the principles and ideals of the party. Because again, reformasi took place, and that's what captured our imagination, that's what made us join the party. And the hope lies very much in this generation, because, you know, we don't have excess baggage, as you would term it. So right now, the focus is, for the next elections, we must make sure all our candidates are professional, fresh, and really credible. And that's being sort of prepared from now, I mean, as we speak. As for, in terms of education, it's a really problematic issue. I think we have, initially it was revolving around PPSMI, program pembelajaran dalam bahasa sains, dalam matematik, dalam bahasa Inggeris. Teaching of maths and science in English. And, you know, it was really defying the logic of even the UNESCO, who stated if you want to teach English, do not teach in technical subjects, especially when technical subjects must be taught in their mother tongue. That's why in Singapore it succeeded, because almost 100% of Singaporeans learn English as a first language. And the biggest problem is we did not have a study. The government did not commission a study when they introduced PPSMI. So for me right now, we really need to seriously think about what's going to happen to our education system. It's eroding seriously. And you know, part of the suggestions we have brought forth is to increase the pay for teachers, even 500 ringgit allowance for all teachers, because we want to make sure right now that the best brains end up becoming teachers. If you look at the study conducted by the UN in Malaysia, those who end up with the worst results end up becoming teachers because they feel that, yeah, there's a reality right now. So I think we need to make sure that once we commission a particular study, implement the series of reforms, stick to it. Again, Singapore didn't come up with a good education system, and trust me, I loathe to compliment Singapore, but you know, again, let's be rational about it. Where they're good, where they deserve it, let's do it. So yeah, any member of parliament, especially Tony Pua, if you say anything good about Singapore, there you go, a Singapore agent. So honestly, in parliament, it really sickens me. So I have to say this, you know, with a qualifier. Yeah, so you look at how many years they came up with that system, and I'm sure we can do it. You know, University Malaya was really once doing so well, and even USM are making necessary changes. But I think we must begin by merging the portfolio of higher education with that of education, because those who basically graduate after high school are those going to be entering university, tertiary education. So you should not segregate the two, separate the two. I mean, that's just my Pakatan Ayat's view on education. But we have been actively involved in a lot of the dialogues that the government has had. It's just that most of our suggestions never actually get accepted. But yeah, I urge you to maybe frequent, we're going to have a long round table on education, and the steps that are needed. Of course, abolishing AUKU is just one particular step, but there's many others that need to be implemented to improve the quality of education in Malaysia. Anyone else? How much time do you have?
Two
more, right? Yes.
Quick one about the environment. So what do you think about these nuclear plants and coal?
Yes, the next one. I'll answer together. Yes, Radin.
In your lecture, you mentioned international intervention, international pressure. In your opinion, how important and how effective is international pressure in instituting political reform?
Okay, anyone else? That one? No? Oh, okay.
All evening, there were no solid discussion on potential economic policies of the opposition party. For example, Malaysia is over $40 billion in debt currently. It has been for the last 2 years. Are there going to be any alternative policies to reduce this debt, or are we going to make the potential more efficient?
Thanks. Okay, number one, in terms of the environment. Yes, there's a highly contentious suggestion to build a nuclear power plant in Malaysia. And following Japan's series of calamities, our position is no to a nuclear power plant, looking at Malaysia's track record of... No, that wasn't meant as a joke. I'm talking about... No, I mean, seriously, if you know, so anyway. Right. So we're actually in a position, you know, and if you look at the mix in our energy mix, nuclear is not one of the main ones that should be promoted first. It's hydro, electric, etc. As for the coal plant, I think you mean the Sabah coal plant. Yeah, we have been so actively working with GreenSurf and so many groups to make sure we protect, what did they call it, the most frontier, the most pristine frontier you know, among one of the most pristine frontier in the world today, in Sabah. And I think the government has decided to halt the project after so much campaign mounted by opposition leaders, bipartisan, mind you. There was Sabah from Putatan MPs and Kalabakan who joined me against the project. So it was quite a nice atmosphere for change. And they were all against the Lahad Datu coal plant project. For now, they have halted the plans. There's also another initiative which we're fighting for, a rare earth plant in Kuantan, involving a certain Australian company. So we're also against that, and we are hoping that we can do something to sort of stop that project from going forward. I invite you to read a New York Times article on this particular subject, and if a lot of Malaysians can speak out, because I think one of the key points or key justifications of having a ministry that includes green technology in its name, which is the Qatar ministry in Malaysia right now, is to ensure we pursue any sort of green technology and make it sort of a major initiative for us. Now, the issue of international pressure, I mentioned it because opposition leaders are pushing, including Dato' Ambika Srinivasan, the non-governmental organisation for free and fair elections, for observers in elections. Sarawak elections, observers for general elections. This has been done before in precedence in Malaysia when we had the Commonwealth come to observe our elections, if I'm not mistaken, 1990 elections. So it is a natural progression, and we are hoping with the considerable reduction of fraud and fraudulent practices in elections, it will make a difference in ensuring that a legitimate government is chosen. And of course, you know, when I mention Egypt, please understand the first choice is always by the ballot box. And the last question in terms of potential economic policies, yes, if you look at the Buku Jingga, it outlines several policy reform initiatives. We are having an economic convention held by Pakatan Rakyat on the 26th and 27th March, specifically to address, I think 26th March, next week actually, to address what exactly the basic a more comprehensive framework on what we mean when we suggest what should be done for to improve the economy. And don't forget, when we came out with the 2009 Pakatan Rakyat budget, majority of which was taken by the federal government, it's good, it's just that when you campaign to the people, oh, you know what, we wrote the budget, the government took this, it's like, doesn't really work that way. So it's also important, I think, for us to highlight all our plans in the economic convention. I would invite you to maybe look at it then, because it will be discussed openly, and we'd like to invite as many people to be involved. Yeah? Okay, any final question? Or no time for final questions? Personal, go ahead, make my day.
Who has more influence on your political career, your mom or your dad?
Well, you know, my father has been such an influential figure in my life. When I was growing up, he was, you know, the up-and-coming star of UMNO. He was deputy prime minister, he was a finance minister. He had such a rich history, you know, in terms of activism, etc. And then my mother, of course, was the first female president of a political party in Malaysia. But I feel that in the 6 years when he was incarcerated, I really grew up literally with past DAP and NGO leaders. You know, I led a relatively sheltered childhood. My best friend would always criticize the government and Mahathir. And I would say, oh, okay, don't worry, I'll bring up to my father and we shall resolve this. And then at one moment in university, I had a sudden panic attack because I saw, you know, university students filling up forms. And they said, who's your favorite political leader in Malaysia? And some wrote, Tuan Guru Ni Aziz, the past leader. Past spiritual leader. And of course I came, you know, my father was an UMNO leader, deputy president at that. how can we have Malaysians supporting the past leadership? So I think the rationale at the time, you know, my father said, well, this is a democracy, so like it or not, there will be people who will not support your initiative. And I learned in the 6 years what a flawed democracy Malaysia was, and the decision I made to contest was actually a very difficult one, and I made it after discussing with my colleagues, Nazmi, Sim. Truth be told, if my father had asked me to do it, I wouldn't do it for him. I think at the end of the day, when you do something, whether studies, whether work, you have to do it because you own the idea. And if I were to just do it because I feel that I want to help my father or my mother, I don't think it'll be fair to the people who voted me in. So yeah, I think that's partly why I did it. And I think it's really worth the pain, because at the end of the day, you know, you must look in not just electoral gains. Electoral gains are brilliant, amazing if you win as a political party. But I think we want to really look at a more democratic Malaysia and a creation of a two-party system. You know, so Pakatan Rakyat can be booted out if BN is doing better. At least people are discussing based on issues rather than personalities. So that's what I can say. Thank you so much for the time.
Please join me one last time in thanking Nurul Izzah. And we look forward to welcoming you back the next time you're in Canberra. Thank you very much. Have a good evening. Be careful of the rain.